Who here fondly remembers their English high school teacher? Raise your hands.
Fondly?
Fondly.
Yeah.
Okay. Let me see those hands again. All right. Joy, what was your English teacher's name?
Mr. Grady.
Mr. Gray?
Grady.
Grady? Okay. Maya?
If it was only in retrospect that I was fond of him, just to say, but I don't remember his name.
Okay.
He's a good guy.
Mr. Phelps.
Mr. Phelps. Elaine?
It was a she, but Mrs. Hennis or something like that. I don't really remember. I remember her face. Not her name.
Some of us have had interesting and engaging English teachers and assignments throughout our high school career. Some of us have had boring and awful English teachers and assignments throughout our high school career. Whatever you've had during your high school career, you had the chance to write an essay, most likely. My English teacher, that I fondly remember, was Mr. Gurness. I'd like you to think of a skinny man with big, thick glasses, crazy hair. He wore corduroy. He walked quickly. He introduced me to the beatniks like Jack Kerouac and Lawrence Ferlinghetti. He brought me to a field trip to Dartmouth University where we saw Allen Ginsberg speak, and he bummed cigarettes for me. This is the kind of teacher that I had, but he introduced me to the power of language. I wrote plays with him and wrote poems with him. And we wrote essays. Now, a common form of an essay is five paragraphs. Your first paragraph is your introduction. Then you have three paragraphs, which is the body or the main point of your essay. Then your final paragraph is your conclusion. So what I'm going to do today is I'm going to help you learn how to organize a speech. And I'd like you, as we go through this presentation, I'd like you to remember how you organized an essay while you were in high school. I do promise to be a little bit more engaging than your English high school teacher. But just like an English high school teacher, I do have a handout. I will save this handout for you to the end. It will go over the points that I brought up here. I don't want you to have this in front of you to give away some of the things that I spoke about or to distract you from my captivating presence. There are many ways to organize your speech, but I want to go over some basic truths in speech organization. Whatever your goal is, whether you want to persuade or educate or inspire, you should always aim to obtain and keep the audience's attention. The words you use and how you organize them will help you show your audience the importance of the speech and the parts within it. As you've seen, when we give a speech at Toastmasters, at the very end of it, we have a chance to provide some feedback. And we do that with what's called the sandwich method. We provide some positive feedback, then we sandwich it with some constructive feedback, and then we go ahead and give some more positive feedback. One of the ways that we will organize a speech is with a different kind of sandwich method. First part. Tell them what you're going to tell them. Then you tell them. Then you tell them what you've told them. Tell them what you're going to tell them. You tell them. Then you tell them what you've told them. Now for the kids in the back, you tell them what you're going to tell them. Tell them. And tell them what you've told them. You'll see that this is a very similar method to how an essay is lined out. Your introduction is the part where you tell them what you're going to tell them. The body of your essay is, tell them! And then the conclusion of your essay is now you're telling them what you've told them. The tell them section is the body of your speech, or your essay, if you will. And once your audience is engaged, the speaker must focus on the point of the speech. You use main ideas and points to back it up. Now this could be quotes, this could be statistics, This could be references. This could be anecdotes. This could be things that you've personally gone through in life. Essentially, to captivate the audience or to keep them going, you want to provide them with something that they can touch onto during the body of the speech. Now you'll remember, hopefully, as we go through this, as you come up with your own speeches, those hand gestures that I used. Tell them what you're going to tell them, and tell them what you've told them. That was very methodical on my part because I want you to remember those different pieces. I want you to build your sandwich. Once you're through with the body, it's time to wrap it up. It's the time to tell them what you've told them. Now, one of the hardest parts for me about giving a speech with Toastmasters is that the speech is timed. We have green and yellow and red cards at different segments of the speech, and I never look at them. Ever. I wish that there was a big flat screen TV in the back that would flash that to me, because I can never remember to look at them, I never see them, and sometimes I'll run off. My point is with that is that you should try to remember those cards. And why this is important is because once you get to the red card, which I see flashing, glaring at me on the table right now, once you get to that red part, you should have the ability to wrap it up. That means you hit your end. And especially in a competition, you can only go about 30 seconds over your, say, 5 minutes or your 7 minutes or your 10 minutes. If you go over the 30 seconds, especially in a competition, you're disqualified. We're not competing here, and it'll be a while before any of the speechcraft participants see a competition. But you should be aware of the time that you're given. And once you give a few speeches at Toastmasters, you will get a sense of how long a speech is. Soon, once you get a few half dozen table topics under your belt, you'll have a good sense of what 2 minutes time is and how long it will take you to fill that. I think that each of the Toastmasters here will agree with me that you get an internal clock in a sense of that. One of the difficulties that people will have when coming up with a speech is coming up with an engaging beginning. You see, what I did there is I asked people who remembers their English teacher fondly. What we're doing here is we're talking about language and communication, which is always something that's always been something that fascinates me, and I feel it's a very powerful tool that we all have. Sometimes people will get writer's block or speaker's block when trying to come up with an engaging beginning. So what I'd invite you to do is work on the meat of the sandwich first. Work on those three paragraphs, if you will. The body. Incorporate some quotes, incorporate some statistics or some anecdotes, and that might inspire you to come up with an engaging beginning. As I was thinking about this, and as I was looking at the guidelines with which I was supposed to give this educational speech, Mr. Gernis popped up in my head. He just did. The fellow that was, I'm sure, an acid freak, popped up into my head. And seriously, he painted his clock black in class one time because he didn't want us to look at it anymore. The guy was on something hardcore. He really was. As we're thinking about those language skills that we have, start in the middle, think of the meat of your sandwich, and then put the bread in your sandwich. Develop your beginning and work on your ending. Or work on your ending and then go back and develop your beginning. It's not nearly as difficult as you think it is. You want to list your key points throughout your speech, though. One of the ways to do that is if you can get the point of your speech down to a single sentence. No matter the speech that you give, you should be able to put it into a single sentence. For example, my speech today, if I were to summarize it, would be how to best organize a speech is to tell them what you're going to tell them, and then tell them what you've told them. One sentence. So no matter what your speech is, you should be able to put it into a succinct sentence and then go from there. If you can't put the speech into a succinct sentence, you might want to think about simplifying it a bit or finding that core piece of what that point is. Because like an essay has a thesis, every speech that you give should have a main point. You want to wrap up your speech by summarizing your main points, and this is in your conclusion. The big piece of this is, if you have a call to action, if I'm trying to persuade you, if I'm trying to sell you something, if I'm a nonprofit, then I'm looking for sponsors. If I am somebody that's at a political organization and I'm looking for people to side with my particular point of view, if you have a call to action, this is where you emphasize it over and over again. You want to make sure that that conclusion really brings it to the front of your speech. Again, go back to the red card, which I see right there, and you'll want to summarize it. That is very helpful. There's another tactic called a mind map, which any of the Toastmasters here can make you familiar with. I don't use that, but what it is you take a piece of paper, you take that sentence, and you put it in the center of your page, and then you go off of it, and you draw your other point, and then you go off of it, and you draw your other point, and you go off of it, and draw your other point. I've never found that to be useful for me, so I invite you to, there we go, thank you, Liz. I invite you to consider that as an option, especially when you're putting your speech together. It helps, certainly helps some people. As you make your way through Toastmasters, and you see more and more speeches, you'll be able to get a sense for a well-developed and a well-organized speech. Versus one that's not. An audience will want to follow along with a speech that makes sense to them intrinsically, not a speech where they're trying to put the pieces together as they go along. That brings this audience out of it. So I invite you to write wonderful speeches, well-organized speeches, because we have to do Mr. Gurness and Mr. Grady. Thank you.